I invite you all to this program. And D.Y. Patil University School of Medicine, who is responsible for organizing the PG lecture series, and also the Siyana Hospital, Lokamanya Tilak Institute of Medical Sciences, the great institutes. Today, I'm going to speak something about the learning theories. Learning theories, as Dr. Nilesh was telling about, usually in the basic sciences like psychology, we would be reading and maybe we would be answering a question there. We are old timers, Dr. Shah and myself. Those days, we have biological psychiatry, psychodynamic psychiatry. In the psychodynamic psychiatry, two schools, psychoanalytic schools, behavioral schools. Behavioral schools, black box. Only behavior, we don't mind anything about the things happening in the mind. And those things which are happening in the mind, analyzing them, the psychoanalytics. Slowly, the behavior therapy has become CBT. The cognitive part has been taken much precedence, and you are much aware about CBT rather than the core behavior therapy principles. I think when I suggested some 10 topics to choose, Dr. Ashwin Cholera has chosen this topic. Why learning theories should be learned? Learning theories are worth knowing. Much human behavior, including overt behavior, thought patterns, and emotions, these are all acquired through learning only. How we think, we learned. How we have to behave outside, how we have to cry, how we have to express our joy, how we have to conceal our joy. So all the things we learned. The etiology and maintenance of psychiatric disorders, for example, phobia. Once he had a bitter experience with a cockroach, such a bitter experience that he can't tell even. The very moment he thinks about the bitter experience, he shivers. So that bitter experience has caused the etiology and maintenance of the phobia. And the learning principles can influence the effectiveness of a therapy. And how to get rid of that phobia, learning theories would be helping. And here, what is learning? Learning is modification of behavior through experience. You had an experience, you had a bitter experience, then you learned it. So indigo flight, okay, indigo flight, true jet flight. True jet people are charging 1,000 rupees less than indigo flight. You opted for true jet. Suddenly 6 hours before, they announced cancellation. Because of choosing true jet for 1,000 rupees, you had to pay 3,000 or 4,000 rupees extra on the day of travel. Then you have learned that you will never travel by true jet. A thing has entered into your mind. Like that, modification of behavior through experience. Acquisition of new behavior patterns. You'll be learning how to behave in the classroom. See, remember those days when you behaved, how you behaved in the classroom during your first standard or second standard. The same way you don't behave, is it not? Because you learned new behavior patterns. Modification and coordination of the responses. How to respond? For example, if somebody slipped while walking on the banana peel, you won't laugh, is it not? You know that it's not etiquette. So like that, modification, coordination, any relatively permanent change in behavior which occurs as a result of practice. The components are acquiring knowledge, broadening of understanding, improvement of skills, development of attitudes, deepening of appreciation. I will not be going into the details of these things. Anyhow, I will be giving the slides in the form of a PDF. And the theoretical parts, I think you can just see. See, the S is stimulus. Here is the response. The child, the infant, 9 months old or 10 months old, a stimulus. Got attracted by the fire, went there. The immediate response is, because learning implies changes. Learning implies development. Learning is adjustment. Learning is universal. Learning is a lifelong process. Learning is not maturation. See, we grow. The growth is not learning. Growth occurs, it's an innate potential. Motivation is not learning. Change in the stimulus is not learning. Fatigue is due to fatigue, we may not learn, or our learning potential may be modified. So that is also not considered to be the learning. What are the goals of learning? The goals of learning are acquisition of knowledge, perceptual knowledge, conceptual knowledge, associational learning, appreciational learning, attitudinal learning, acquisition of skills. Perceptual learning, through all our five senses, we will be learning so many things. That is perceptual learning. We take the senses and keep it in the mind. With the already the mental knowledge we have, we get the perception. Conceptual learning, sensation, perception, mental image, analysis, abstraction, generalization, concept formation. For example, we had a better experience with a Chinese man, or we had a better experience with an African man, because he has stolen something from our computer and deceived us for some money, Nigeria people and all. So we try to generalize that one. Although in Nigeria, so many intellectuals are there, so many good people are there, so many charitable work is going on, but because of certain Nigerian people, we developed a generalization. Abstraction, generalization, concept formation. Associational learning. When lightning is there, immediately we associate it with thunder because we learnt it. Sour smelling milk, that tastes bad. Unexpected loud noise, startled response. Chopping of onions, tears. So like that, we'll be learning the things, associational. Appreciational learning, attaching a value to the knowledge. An infant may not be knowing the difference between an ordinary paper and a currency note. But gradually we learn that this currency note has a value. So this is appreciational learning. Attitudinal learning, developing an inclination. A mischievous boy. So these people learned an attitude towards that boy. And in this learning, reflexes play a role, fixed action patterns, elicited behaviors, that you will be learning. As Dr. Shah was telling, so many theories are there in the here behaviorism, Skinner, Bandura, Thorndike, Pavlov, Watson, Guthrie, Hull, cognitivism, so many names are there, constructivism, so many names are there. These are for the sake of theory. But some are there which are very important for psychiatrists. Those things we will be discussing about. Representation of the learning process, behaviorism, stimulus response, reinforced behavior, antecedent behavior consequence, sequence knowledge and skills, limited steps, cognitivism. So these things, I think the theory part, you will be getting the material. SR theories, S is stimulus, R is response. Here, you just think about the three things, three components. Antecedents, behavior, consequences. Antecedents are usually the stimulus. B, behavior is the response. And C, the consequences, the environmental response towards your response. The environmental response may be a reward, or may be punishment, or may be some indifference, may be something. So here, between these three components, the learning theories will be oscillating. SR theories are stimulus response oriented. If you give certain stimulus, you will get certain response. Response and environmental reward and punishment are different type of theories. Now we'll see SR theories or connectionist theories, those are called. Among them, classical Pavlovian conditioning is the gold standard. It is called classical conditioning, type S conditioning, respondent conditioning, substitution learning, signal learning. So these are all the synonyms. Ivan Pavlov or Ivan Pavlov, he is called 1849-1936. He was given Nobel Prize in Physiology. As you know,
psychologists have come up with new views, not only of animal behavior, but of human nature as well. And these views all concern a process that we take for granted, learning, because we are all truly born to learn. Ironically, one of the most important figures in the study of learning, Ivan Pavlov, wasn't concerned with the subject at all, at least not at first. Pavlov, a noted Russian scientist, won the Nobel Prize for Physiology and Medicine in 1904. As this original footage shows, Pavlov was initially interested in digestion and the action of the salivary glands. By diverting the saliva of dogs into test tubes, he could precisely measure if and how much they salivated during digestion. When food was presented, the dog salivated quickly, an inherited salivary reflex.
We have skipped the half part of that one, as we'll be discussing about it. Actually, his interest was to study the salivation and the digestive processes and all. But surprisingly, even before the food is presented, some dogs are salivating. How is it happening? Then he understood it is not only the presence of the food, sight of the food, but some other stimuli in the environment are responsible for the genesis of this reflex action of salivation. Then he conducted the experiments by clubbing the bell sound with the food, and he associated. Here, this conditioning occurs when neutral stimuli are associated with psychologically significant event. For example, we had a bitter experience with a snake, or we know about the danger of the snakes. But the way the snake crawls, the wriggling movement, the way it looks, even a benign worm also, an earthworm or some worm also looks like that. Although that benign earthworm doesn't do anything to us, the moment we see that one, we get some very unpleasantness. Even when some anthelmintic is taken, when the roundworm comes out of the stool also, we get so fear. And although that roundworm doesn't do anything, although that roundworm was present in the intestines for many years or so, not many years, but many months or so, but still we feel so afraid of these things. These are the association things, the conditioning. Pavlov's problem was experienced dogs salivated before the food was presented. Pavlov's theory, some stimulus that preceded the food presentation had acquired capacity to elicit the response of salivation. So here, this conditioning, this association, it is responsible, the cues responsible for anxiety disorders and the dependence problems also. For example, somebody had a panic disorder, panic attack, while he is going shopping. He went out to the marketplace and then he had a panic attack. And because of the panic attack, and he was feeling as if he was dying. And of course, he recovered and came back. Since then, he developed a phobia, agoraphobia. He just doesn't go out at all. He doesn't go for shopping at all because he associated that marketplace with this one. Similarly, post-traumatic stress disorders also. Whatever the things happened around that event, the utterance of the word beach, because such a traumatic experience occurred during the beach. Because of the trauma, the very utterance of the word beach itself produces a lot of anxiety. Similarly, the dependence problems also. Dependence, because it has produced some pleasantness with some occasion, whenever that occasion occurs, he continues that one. Some people you might have heard, why are you smoking, man? Unless I smoke, I don't get, I get constipation. To relieve that constipation while going to the toilet, I smoke. What is the relationship between smoking and toilet? Got associated, got conditioned. So here, the terminology you have to remember. Unconditional stimulus, unconditional response. Here, nothing learning has occurred. It is a reflex thing. Unconditional stimulus is food. Unconditional reflex is salivation. So this is unconditional. US and UR. Here, the conditional stimulus is bell has got nothing to do with the salivation generally. But here, because we clubbed it with an unconditional stimulus, the conditional stimulus is bell. For that conditional stimulus, conditional response is salivation. So salivation is unconditional response for unconditional stimulus, and it is conditional response for this conditional stimulus of ringing the bell. Paradigm of classical conditioning. First, select a stimulus that automatically elicits a characteristic response. Stimulus, unconditional stimulus, unconditional response. Select a stimulus for conditioning. Conditioned stimulus can be any reasonable stimulus that doesn't initially evoke UR. That means bell has got nothing to do with this one. So you select that one. then you club these two things and you will get that one. So here the food automatically elicits salivation. You clubbed with the bell. Bell initially no salivation, but when the bell is clubbed with the food, salivation occurs. So even without offering the food also, on hearing the bell, the dog will salivate. Key definitions already I told you, unconditioned stimulus, unconditioned response, CS and CR. And sometimes these things get generalized also. You started with a bell, some bell, and some calling bell like. Then later you shifted to temple bell. Then you shifted to some sound which resembles bell. So even then, generalization occurs. Sometimes discrimination also we can teach the dog. Whenever we ring temple bell and calling bell, we will be offering food. But whenever we are buzzing with some electronic bell-like sound, we don't give food. Then it tries to discriminate also. Even the wavelengths also, very subtle things also, it will get the ability to distinguish. Generalization, the flavors also, sometimes we can make it learn. Which flavor will produce the food, which flavor doesn't produce, and so on. Sometimes the learning theories, extinction also occurs. When there is no repetition, initially we clubbed bell ringing with food and it started salivation. But gradually we stopped giving food when the bell is rung. So it occurs, salivation occurs for 4 times, 5 times, 10 times, but not 100 times, is it not? Slowly the extinction occurs. Conditioning is not necessarily permanent. Extinction occurs when the CS is presented repeatedly without US. CS no longer signals US, so conditioned responding gradually diminishes. But CS-US association is not erased completely. But when we started it again, immediately it learns, because already it was there in the memory. Blocking occurs. Instead of giving food, we are giving an electric shock. So what happens? The opposite response. It gets confused. It doesn't know what to do, whether it gets food or whether it gets electric shock. So tries to avoid the bell ringing because it blocks that one. Frustration occurs sometimes. You see this one? When anticipation and expectation is too much, when the things do not occur, we become so irritable, out of frustration. So this learning and unlearning, like the dog's tail, which we make to try to correct it remains to some extent, but if we do not continue the practice, it goes back. Rapid reacquisition can occur. When we blocked it or when extension phase was over, again we can reconditioning phase, reacquisition phase, rate of learning is faster the second time. Continues to get faster with repeated cycles. Presentation of US and CS, when these two things, that means condition stimulus, bell, immediately food, that is short delay, moderate delay, bell rung, food is given after a little late, long delay, food is given after half an hour, simultaneously given, both bell ringing and food is given, backward, first food is given, later the bell was rung, which is the best you think? Short. Short delay is the best one. Which is the worst one? Backward is the worst one. Naturally, is it not? Short delay is the best. Moderate delay more difficult to achieve. CR, long delay difficult to achieve. Simultaneous, much weaker conditioning than short delay. Backward, usually not effective. Higher ordering conditioning. See, conditioned. Bell is conditioned with food. I think we can go further also. Bell, showing a pen, and then food, for example. First she showed the pen, and after showing the pen, after half a minute, you rang the bell. And after half a minute, you gave the food. So immediately after seeing the pen itself, the dog will anticipate saying that, thinking that the bell will ring, and also the food will come. So second order. Third order sometimes. First keychain is shown and keys are shown, then pen, then bell, then food. So one can learn even the order also, the third order also. So this is the thing which is depicted in the picture. Classical fear conditioning can contribute to phobias. Panic disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, already external cues, interoceptive cues. External cues like the sounds and all, environmental. Interoceptive cues like palpitation, sweating, The anxiety, physiological symptoms themselves will be responsible for reinforcement of the anxiety. The nightmares and re-experiencing phenomena that are characteristics, these are all conditioned. Repeated exposure to the conditioned stimulus without US, unconditioned stimulus, exposure therapy, that is the therapy for phobia. Previously, this person had very bitter experience with a lizard, so developed phobia. Now, we are giving a lizard doll, a lizard small toy, and with that one playing and very pleasant music given along with the chocolates, so much pleasant things are going on. So gradually the exposure, without any tension, naturally the person comes out of the phobia. A horse is afraid of balloons. How the systematic desensitization is done, you see. They are giving alpha-alpha pellets along with this one exposure. Showing the balloon, giving the food. Showing the balloon, giving the food. Next step was to have Charlotte is the horse's name. Touching the balloon and giving the food. The final phase, to touch with the balloon and allowing for a long time. Systematic desensitization you have seen, this is flooding. claustrophobia flooding. Again, one more thing for flooding. Ichthyophobia. Phobia of fish. So here, systematic desensitization and flooding. In systematic desensitization, as you know, we form a hierarchy. For example, somebody with cockroach phobia. Even the very word of cockroach itself gets phobia. Even before entering into the bathroom also, he asks his wife to check whether there is any cockroach inside the bathroom. Then after getting the clearance only, he comes. And he lost so many opportunities. Promotions, attending the conferences, nothing. He became a frog in the well only, and always thinking about cockroaches. Whereas in flooding, he will be taken to your room. Surprisingly, there will be hundreds of cockroaches there. And how long he will cry? How long he will shout? How long he will get the fear? Half an hour? 1 hour? Gradually he gets accustomed to it. And another one is the word implosion we use, the word implosion for flooding. Flooding is the real situation, implosion is in thought, as if he is there in the situation where the things are going on. Then aversion therapy. Do you practice aversion therapy here, sir? Because this is considered to be a barbarian treatment, very painful treatment, and we should not give shocks to the people. Giving so many shocks to the people is really bad. So, but aversion therapy really works so well. Watson's Little Albert experiment. It's a well-known experiment. How the children get conditioned. What he says is, the child's mind is like a clean slate. Anything we can write. And he has challenged in such a way that Watson's 12 infants challenge. You give me 12 infants. You ask me whom to make a doctor, whom to make an engineer, whom to make a beggar, whom to make a thief. I can make. That is the challenge. Of course, it is criticized by human rights activists. Basic associative learning process, human emotions are influenced by classical conditioning. Learning is as simple as ABC, antecedents, behavior, consequence. Watson's dozen infants quote, give me a dozen healthy infants, well-formed, and my own specified world to bring them up, and I'll guarantee to take anyone at random and train him to become any type of specialist, I mean, doctor, lawyer, artist, merchant, or even beggar, thief, regardless of his talents, penchants, tendencies, abilities, vocations, and his answer. little Albert, who got conditioned to rat with loud sound, and after getting the fear with the rat, even the anything for like, he's getting the fear. Generalization occurs, discrimination occurs. Even the ferocious dog also did not evoke any fear in him. White rat with sound.
Watson shows Albert the rat accompanied by a loud clanging noise. One of the few things that upsets little Albert. And he does it again. And does it again.
That loud sound made him to become phobic for the white things like. And then Edward Lee Thorndike. His cat. Puzzle box experiments. What he says is the learning occurs through trial and error. Anybody learns through trial and error, he says. Even the dog, even the cat also, when it is offered food or to come out of the box, it would be doing many, many maneuvers, and one of the maneuvers would succeed, and it learns. Then the same thing it will be repeating in future also. Trial and error.
Hello, my name is Professor Edward Thorndike. I'm going to demonstrate my classic experiment, which empirically tests the laws of learning. First, I will place this cat into this puzzle box.
So trial and error is the Thorndike's theory with different stages: drive, goal, blocking, random movements, chance success, selection of proper movement, and the fixation. So this is the sequence. He has put forward certain laws, primary laws of learning: law of readiness, law of effect, law of exercise, law of belongingness. Law of readiness means the person should be in a position to learn. That means, for example, a child of 6 years cannot be taught psychiatry because that conduction unit or the animal or the human being is not in a position to understand that one. When a conduction unit is ready to conduct, not to conduct is annoying. When somebody is in a ready position to learn, if not offering the learning, that is annoying. And when a conduction unit is not ready to conduct and is forced to conduct also is annoying. You are not interested in psychiatry, but you are forced to take up this course. It is annoying naturally. So these are the law of readiness. maturation, motivation, wants, interests, attitudes, desire to learn, academic readiness and preparation. The law of effect, if a response to a particular situation is followed by a satisfying or pleasant consequence, it will be strengthened. If a response to a particular situation is followed by unsatisfying or unpleasant consequence, it will be weakened. For example, in whatever way he is playing the musical instrument, she is showing some pleasure and it is naturally encouraging for him and he will be doing it more and more. When he chatted something or he spoke something, it was annoying to her, naturally the association will be weakened here. Law of effect. Modified law of effect. Effect of reward is far more influential than punishment. Anybody, if you give punishment, the effect will be less. If you give reward and praising him, calling him onto the dais and claps and giving some 10 rupees worth pen will work wonders rather than shouting at somebody who has not done. That's why people say praise in the public and reprimand in the isolation. Law of exercise. See, in plus 2 or 10th class or so, the teachers would be so good. Even the IAS coaching centers, they would be teaching so well. Then why they did not become IAS? They could not pass. They could not succeed even after five attempts also. But how could they become good teachers? Because of exercise. Because hundreds of times they read it, hundreds of times they taught it, they became masters. Law of belongingness. Reward or punishment to be maximally effective must be relevant to the situation. When there is no relevance, suddenly punishing the person or suddenly giving a reward for no reason. See, the children, suddenly giving some ice cream, suddenly giving some chocolate, or allowing to watch some cartoon network will not be working because doesn't know why it is happening. So we have to associate. Because you got glass first, you are given this party. So some association, some belongingness, yes, this is mine. Subordinate loss or loss of multiple response, law, attitude or sector, so these things I think will be consuming a lot of time. Then Skinner's, operant conditioning or R-type conditioning. Here the response, the behavior of the individual evoking the response from the environment in the form of reward or punishment, which will lead to the learning. Learning about the consequences of behavior, a procedure for studying how organisms learn about the consequences. Realization that our actions lead to outcomes. Operating on your environment, you can produce a positive or negative consequence. Basic law of operant conditioning. If the occurrence of an operant is followed by presentation of reinforcing stimulus, the strength is increased. How can we make an elephant to roll on the bar? So initially it starts with a small movement. Small movement given a lot of reward. Small movement given a lot of, ultimately it goes to such a level. Somehow getting a response to occur, then reinforce it. You see practically how the things will happen. The difference between classical and operant conditioning, you know, these things I think. When it presses the lever, it gets the food. So it guaranteed. Pressing the lever is the rewarding experience, so it keeps on operating. Consequences that increase the likelihood of the behavior occurring again is reinforcement. The difference between positive reinforcement and negative reinforcement. Usually we get confused. Positive reinforcement means reward, negative reinforcement means punishment we think, but it is not so. Positive reinforcement means giving something pleasant is positive reinforcement. Negative reinforcement means that is also a pleasant thing, but taking away a bad thing. See, you are given some punishment and out of that punishment you are relieved out of it. That itself is a reinforcement, is it not? That's not negative reinforcement. And punishment also, positive punishment, and negative punishment is withholding something. Positive punishment is you are put on
imprisonment for 2 years or 3 years, that is positive punishment. Whereas positive punishment is negative punishment is removing certain rewards. For example, a school child is there, because the child is mischievous, child is kept outside, put on a high chair so that she cannot get down, and for
certain time she would be made to sit there. Partial reinforcement schedules, that means not every event would be reinforced, but once in 3 or once in 5, like that it may be. So here the difference between fixed ratio and variable ratio, for every 3 pulling the lever, it gets the pellet. That is fixed ratio. Variable ratio, we do not know when the pellet comes. Maybe after 3, maybe after 5, maybe after 6. That is fixed ratio and variable ratio. Whereas fixed interval, variable interval, every 10 seconds the pellet will come. No, we do not know the time, variable interval. So which is the best thing you think for learning? Variable ratio, it fixes. Variable ratio means it occurs, but we do not know when it occurs. Maybe after 10 times, maybe after 15 times, maybe after one time only. Variable ratio is the best for hooking the learning. Interval things are the least ones. That's why gamblers, why they get addicted to that? They keep on. They do not know when they get the winning. Maybe after 5 times, maybe after 10 times. Suddenly, 10 times the stake, he will be getting it. But he doesn't know when. Maybe the next time I may get. Maybe the next time I may get. He keeps on playing that one. So variable ratio schedule is hardest to extinguish. Once they hook to that one, effects on behavior, continuous reinforcement, okay, I have already spoken to. Successive approximations and chaining, small things kept together, we can really work wonders. Successive approximations to the goal behavior, reinforcement, anything which increases desired behavior.
Token economy, the chronics, the phrenics and all, when they do something positive, they will be given offered tokens. And they collect the tokens and they exchange it for small items like. Response prevention, exposure and response prevention. This helps, of course, I mean, because of the aversion treatment associated with the painful things and all, in the response prevention also, we can do with aversion. For example, the hysterical behavior, even if you talk so much, even they say so many things, after going from hospital, they again be doing it. Here, obsessive compulsions also. When they feel that their hands are dirty, they go to for washing. Instead of going for washing, they come to our behavior therapy apparatus, they get the shock so that they come out of the feeling. And they hold the mud for some time, and whenever they feel like washing, they come to the machine in this way. Exposure and response prevention. This is scientific indeed, but unfortunately, people neglected this one. Then Hull, need reduction theory, drive reduction theory, drive stimulus reduction theory. Give you some cues, reinforcement and response. Organisms suffer deprivation. Deprivation creates needs. Needs activate drives. Drives activate behavior. Behavior is goal directed. Achieving the goal has survival value. So this is his theory. You see, people usually say, the children of wealthy people, they can't be educated well compared to an auto rickshaw wala's son. Because auto rickshaw wala's son has that motivation, that need, that drive inside. My father is suffering a lot. I'll become an IAS collector and show the world how great our family is. Whereas a wealthy man, a multimillionaire's son, whether I study or not, what is bothering, let us think about the 3 lakhs rupees or 5 lakhs rupees motorbike which has come into the market. So his thinking would be this way. So drive and need. Then Albert Bandura, Bobadal. Bobadal is the doll which maintains the gravity. When it is thrown also, it stands. That is called Govardha. Bandura was of our times only, died only a few decades ago. Not of Pavlov's age also. And he had a PhD scholar. He made experiments with the PhD scholar and he did the videos. People are not driven by either inner forces or environmental stimuli. Initial behaviors are learned through continuous interaction of personal and environmental determinants. And all learning from direct experience occurs by observing other people. That is social learning or modeling. Social observational learning occurs when organisms responding is influenced by observation of others. Allows organisms to learn without requiring their own trial and error experience. Modeling occurs when an organism imitates the behavior of others. Social learning or modeling. Vicarious reinforcement, vicarious punishment have effects on behavior that parallel Thorndike's law of effect. Reinforcement that occurs when you imitate the behavior of someone who has been reinforced for that behavior. Because Rajnikanth do like that only, he became a great star. I think I can also do like that so that I can also become a star. Punishment that refers to the tendency not to repeat behaviors that we observe others punished for. Here, from Maharashtra only, Dr. Hegdevar. Had the name Hegdevar?
Yes.
Maharashtra doctor. He studied MBBS in Calcutta. Bengalis were averse towards Maharashtrians. So somehow they did not like Maharashtra people staying there in the room there. So they were pelting stones on their roof. They do not know how to control that pelting. So what Dr. Hegdevar was done was, he came out and caught hold of one innocent man and he started beating. And people came and, why are you beating him? Somebody is pelting stones, but he is not pelting, is it not? But I do not know who is pelting, so I feel like beating him. Since then, we stopped beating itself. So vicarious things also happen. Application, skills training, vicarious exposure to adaptive behaviors, limiting exposure to maladaptive behaviors. Cognitive field theories, cognitivism, learning is a change of knowledge, state knowledge acquisition is described as mental activity. Learner is viewed as an active participant in the learning process. Emphasis is on the building blocks of knowledge. Emphasis on structuring, organizing and sequencing information to facilitate optimal processing. Robert Gagne's theory, signal learning, stimulus response learning, chaining, verbal association, discrimination, concept, rule learning, problem solving. These are all the theory things I think you can read. Kohler's theory is the inside theory of gestalt psychologists. He has got a chimpanzee called Sutta. What he says is, it is nothing like trial or error, it is nothing like stimulus or response. The human being suddenly gets experience. I got a similar experience in the ophthalmology posting. People were showing through the ophthalmoscope, seeing through the ophthalmoscope and describing the fundus. Somehow, while seeing through the ophthalmoscope, I was unable to see anything at all. For 1 week, I was just pretending as if I am saying something. But suddenly, after 10 days or 15 days, everything became so clear. Everything started appearing to me. Initially, when I entered into psychiatry, I was so confused. What is the difference between thought and emotion? Thought and emotion are same, is it not? In the mind it is occurring, same activity. What is this difference? I was so confused. But after 2 weeks or 3 weeks, suddenly, emotion is this, thought is that. When I was living with my brother, during my intermediate stage, your friend has come. He came on a motorbike or a scooter, he asked me. Really, I do not know the difference between scooter and motorbike, I told him. During plus two stage. See, sometimes things so happen, suddenly we get aha-like experience and everything occurs. The inside theory of gestalt psychologist, Sultan, learning, and gestalt laws applicable to learning. We see the whole, not the components. The fundamental principle of gestalt perception is the law of pregnance in the German language. It says that we tend to order our experience in a manner that is regular, orderly, symmetric, and simple. C See here, when you see this one, actually these are some circles cut. But when we keep together, we see the triangle. Initially we don't see the triangle, but when we see that one, we try to fit in. Similarly here also, we see a sphere with spines. And also here, we see as if these are there incorporated in the ground. So like that, the whole is greater than the sum of the parts, that is the gestalt way. You know about this one, the figure and the ground. When we start seeing, we see only one thing, either two faces or the vase. But later, suddenly, that aha experience comes. Oh, here this one is there, like that we get. Similarly here also, the vase and the two elderly faces. Here also, we see only horses, but nothing else. Somebody was telling, a beautiful woman's face is also there. Where is the woman's face? I am unable to see. But suddenly that aha occurs. Ah, woman's face is there. Adult learning can be epochal in sudden transformation of the learner's perception. The law of closure. When there are gaps, we try to complete. Even in the patients also, they read in between the lines. More they read in between the lines, more psychotic they become. They get more thought disorders and so on. The law of similarity. The mind groups similar elements. Actually, there are certain things, but we try to group them, whites and blacks. And here also, there is nothing like spatial and temporal proximity also, we try to group them. We try to organize them. Actually, we are not seeing the underlying key. Actually, it is broken, but we perceive it as if there is a key underneath. The law of good continuation. It is the interaction between two or more objects. People try to perceive each object as a single, uninterrupted object. This allows differentiation. The law of common fate. See, actually here are dots only. But we perceive the dots as birds, as if all the birds are going in one direction only. We perceive. But where is the bird? We could not see. But we know that they are going somewhere. They are flying together. They are flying to in this direction. And so on. Grown-ups. From the known to unknown. Learning occurs. Learning best occurs from known. Whenever you have to teach somebody, you start with the things which is known to it, known to the people. And then go to the unknown. Don't start with the unknown things. Because whenever you give a lecture, half of it is already known to them, half of it is not known. When we start with a known thing, they will be much connected to you. And again, from simple to complex, start with a simple thing, they will be understanding and they get the attitude towards you and go to the complex one. Start with a concrete one and go to the abstract one. So these are the principles of Brunner. Principle of least effort. Then an organism chooses the one that will require the shortest route, shortcuts, or anything that will only require minimum amount of energy, usually the organism learns. A picture of something that an organism usually is encountering when it does something. When a person walks on the same street every day, he will know that when he turns to his left, he will see this, and when he turns to the right, he will see that one. So we will be having a picture, and according to that picture, we will be continuing to do. Confirmation versus reinforcement. Confirmation of expectancy. We expect something, and when the expectation is consistently confirmed, the organism ends up believing. And you think that when it acts in a certain way, a certain result will be obtained. Even in our comprehensive textbook of psychiatry, there is a chapter, Learning Theories and Psychosis. Well, we know that psychosis because of the biochemical errors in the brain. And of course, some environmental factors, some psychodynamics would be, but learning theories also. They learn the things, they learn to hallucinate, they learn to get the delusions. Of course, the explanations seem to be somewhat far-fetched, but maybe for the sake of examination point of view, may read about those ones. Constructivism, social interaction, cognitive development, social development theory. He believed that social interaction played a role in the development of cognition. Learning could occur through social contact. Every function in the child's cultural development appears twice, first on the social level and then later on the individual level. First between people, then inside the child. The basic premise is that adult provides the support and the scaffolding for the individual until the individual assimilates the knowledge into their cognitive structure. The idea behind scaffolding is that the support system is gradually taken away as the learner begins to take over and understand the process. You know about the wolf child and all, a girl who was reared by the wolves in the forest, behaving like a wolf only. You know about the things. So here is theory. So okay, we are coming to the end. What are the implications from laboratory to clinics, from rats to human beings? And whatever we learned here in the form of Skinner or Pavlo or Watson, we try to put into practice by extrapolating the things. Behavior therapy. We were taught about the cognitive things, but cognitive behavior therapy was not replacing the behavior therapy. Since the 1970, the field of behavior therapy, now called cognitive behavior therapy, has accepted what seems to be a wide range of explanatory principles, often grounded in social psychology, and at least nominally in an information processing cognitive perspective. Learner maladaptive behaviors, escape from fear or anxiety, is believed to play a significant role in many human behavior disorders, including the anxiety disorders. Obsessive compulsive patient checks or washes the hands repeatedly to reduce anxiety. Agoraphobic stays home to escape fear of places associated with panic attacks. Bulimic learns to vomit after a meal to reduce the learned anxiety evoked by eating that meal. Whether the behavior is a respondent or operant, and then the clinician will go about changing either it's, and as I was telling in the beginning, you just think about this ABC. What are the antecedents? What is the behavior? What are the consequences? How to change the behavior by modifying the antecedents or by rewarding or punishing or changing the consequences? This is as simple as this. Pavlovian fear conditioning interacts with the reinforcement of an instrumental action for varied results. A child might likewise learn to stay away from the parent. See, always it doesn't work like mathematics principle. See, for example, the child has to be punished for his maladaptive behavior. So does the child get corrected? But things may work in a worse way. A child might likewise learn to stay away from the parent who delivers punishment rather than refrain from performing the punishment behavior. Instead of correcting the behavior, he will try to avoid the punishing person. A great deal of behavior in operant learning settings may actually be controlled by Pavlov learning. There is nothing like a hard and fast rule where Pavlov ends and where Skinner starts. Everything is something like a big thing. So, with this talk, I think, I hope the man-hours spent by you here.